Hey guys, guess who we just saw yesterday? Guess who we just saw? Sorry, just had to show off our. Well, I knew it to our merch because we saw Queen yesterday. Yeah, I'd cider pretty good. And today, one of my most requested bands, Queen. Everyone wants to know my opinions on Queen, and I brought with me the residential Roger Taylor expert. And yeah, we're gonna talk about all 15 of these albums. But first, since we are doing Queen, I think we need to dress up.
I think it's appropriate.
Yeah, we need to dress up. So we will be right back. We will be right back after these messages. Don't go anywhere. Hey, what's up? It's your boy Link. I'm joined here with my princess.
Hi, I'm Princess Zelda.
Wow. Well, celebrating Queen, we might as well dress up like soccer moms. I don't even know what this hairdo is anymore. Anyway, today we're talking about all 15 studio Queen albums. So we're gonna go ahead and get this kicking because this is going to be an eternity. So coming in at a unanimous last place, we're going to have the Flash Gordon soundtrack. Here it is. Here's Freddy with his glorious Flash outfit. But we're not ranking outfits or album artworks. So today we're ranking the actual albums. And by far, easily coming in last place is the Flash soundtrack.
I concur.
Wouldn't you agree?
Yes.
Because let's be real, man. If I want to listen to the movie, I'll watch the movie, but listen to it. Point is that too much of it is filled with clips from the movie, and I really don't know why they would do that. Should have just been the actual music. Not to mention that literally all the only one that even has like lyrics is the main Flash theme that everyone knows.
Yeah, but that you were even saying still kind of has some movie clips in there too,
Yeah,
so.
even that half movie clips and like you hear it, vocals show up every once in a while, but it's just Flash, all the everything just comes from the first track, basically.
Yeah, he's the savior of the universe, but not the savior of this group of albums. Sorry.
Yeah, man. The hero and the battle are kind of musically there, but not enough to make this anywhere but last.
All right, my number 14 is their very first album, Queen.
Yeah, right.
See, and it kind of pains me to say that a little bit because I like it, but there's just some songs that I don't really like mesh with, like Jesus, like I just don't mesh with, I don't know, super religious songs. That statement's gonna come back to bite me in the butt later, but we'll get to that. Doing All Right, I love that song, especially because Smile recorded that song before Queen, and that's pre-Queen stuff. But it was nice to hear both versions of it, and I do prefer the Queen version of it so much better. And Modern Times Rock and Roll is fantastic. Those were pretty much my two standout songs. Oh, yeah. Whoopity-doo-dah.
So coming at number 14, we have, I call it like the epilogue album, Made in Heaven. And I hope that's not too much of a controversy because I think this thing is similar to what Pink Floyd did with The Endless River, where it's kind of like a bunch of old recordings that they redid once Richard Wright and all. They just wanted to put an album out. Not that this one, it was like a bunch of old recordings. Like, I guess the story is Freddie just wanted to get as much on tape as he could before he flew away, as some would say. And like, that's great and all, but at the end product feels like a bunch of songs that all kind of sound the same. They all have that same soft vibe, which moving forward, you will notice that those are not my favorite type of Queen songs. So, because this whole thing is basically all those songs, like Let Me Live, I guess, was my personal highlight.
Is a good one.
But yeah, like many don't view Endless River as a proper Pink Floyd album, I don't really view this as a proper Queen album.
Understandable,
even
but
though
ouch.
Even though it maybe is, technically is, but that's just me.
The next one is A Day at the Races. And, you know, the way that I kind of...
My list is not going to be the controversial one in this video. I can already guarantee it.
I mathematically figure out where everything goes. I rank each song on every album out of 5 and then take the average out of all of the scores. And that's how I come up with my list, okay? So, A Day at the Races. I mean, I don't know. What was it? The Millionaire Waltz is, you know, it's just okay. I love it because it's an actual waltz. So I think it's really clever in that sense. Not my favorite. And neither is White Man. Again, kind of... politically type of stuff, kind of like the tougher subjects to talk about, and I'm glad that they, you know, had songs that were, you know, the tougher subjects to talk about, but this one, I just didn't really super mesh with, but like Good Old Fashioned Lover Boy is amazing. I mean, Somebody to Love is on here. Teo Toriate is great. I mean, that's probably the highlight of this album, I'd say. It's they got some good songs on here, and Freddie's voice is just very, very, like, soft and emotional on this one, and that's what I absolutely love about this album. So I am kind of sad it ended up where it did, but such is life.
Okay, all right, now for the actual start of my Queen ranking. Coming in number 13, we have... Coming at number 13, we have A Kind of Magic, more like A Kind of Mid.
Ooh, all right.
This whole thing is kind of a mid fest, except the live performance, like their whole background design and like the animated guys they have. That looks very cool. But as far as the songs themselves go, the only one I really kind of like is Who Wants to Live Forever, which is a shame because that is straight up, like, probably top 5 Queen songs right there. Gets me every time. And then also the instrumental closer.
Forever.
What's it called? Forever. Yeah. That one is also good because it's pretty much the same thing. And also when I found out that Michael Kamen scored this thing, I was like, of course he did. That's why it's so... so good. But yeah, everything else, really, that song is the only reason it's even above Made in Heaven, I think. Because, yeah, nothing else on here really stands out for me. Sorry, A Kind of Magic fans.
I know a lot of people can't agree with me on this one.
Wait, double whammy. My next one is also Hot Space.
Oh, here we go. Okay. That's A Kind of Magic, but we've already talked about that one.
Yeah. Well, I have.
You have. I haven't. So, I guess this one is kind of like a different sound for Queen. And I know Queen, and they have a specific sound, and it's not this one. Mm. But that's not to say that it's a bad sound, but it's just an unfamiliar sound for Queen. And I like that familiar Queen sound. Like, I don't know. Back Chat sounds kind of cool. I think that's awesome. I always really enjoyed Action This Day. That's a pretty decent one. And Las Palabras de Amor is a very beautiful song. Let Me Hear the Words of Love.
I also really like Action This Day.
You've got good taste.
It was my second favorite song on this album because everyone knows what my number one favorite song in this album is, right?
It's got to be Under Pressure.
Duh. I mean, even like, though that it really... fucking moving this hair like it's my own. It does not fit on this album at all. And that's because they didn't write it on this album. They just threw it on here.
Yeah.
And it shows because everything is super synthesized and everything. And then there's this song, which... again, is like one of their best songs. So it just kind of makes me mad that Bowie and Mercury didn't do a whole album together.
I know. Seriously, when you fuse Bowie and Queen, they can do anything. But before we, you know, end with this one here. Let me just say that Life is Real, the song for John Lennon, that one actually does sound very similar to a John Lennon-esque type of song. So that is a really cool sound. I do like that. The next one we got here is Queen 2.
Queen Dose.
Queen 2. This is a really iconic picture, by the way. Bohemian Rhapsody.
It's probably the iconic picture for them.
I'm not going to bring that up. I'm not going to bring that up because Bohemian Rhapsody is not on this album, yet this is from the Bohemian Rhapsody music video. Yeah. And this is before Bohemian Rhapsody.
Indeed.
Okay, moving on.
For all you didn't know that.
Moving on. So, you know, this is another kind of album, but... It starts off with Procession, which is okay. I just got distracted by the picture. Whoa. And all of the fluffiness that's going on. Wow. They're like angels from heaven sent by God. Anywho, yeah, it opens up with Procession. Procession is just an okay song for me. Wasn't the strongest opening to an album. But that's okay. Definitely love Nevermore. It's a short little song on here, but it is so pretty. Again, with Freddie's voice just getting so emotional and soft, and other times it like gets so powerful and strong, and it's got everything that I want to hear from Freddie in a song. And so it's basically perfect, that song. And I mean, obviously you have Seven Seas of Rye on here, which I think is an okay song, but if I'm in the mood, I could, like, really get down to Seven Seas of Rye. Like, seriously, in the pirate shanty that's at the end there, like, man, that is so cool. Overall, I kind of like the fairy tale kind of theme in this one, but there are definitely better albums to come.
Alright, so we have the objectively the best song on this album, Man on the Prowl. I think that one just goes super ham because it just kind of sounds like an Elvis song. And yeah, even the hits on here, like I Want to Break Free, great. Great, wonderful. Pretty good song. I mean, yes. That kind of inspired this whole getup. It's a Hard Life, I'm not super crazy about. Radio Gaga, I'm not super crazy about. The only part I really like in that song is the end of the chorus, you know, someone loves you, whatever. I really like that part, but like the main groove, the like whatever that shit is, I don't really like it. And everything else is just kind of whatever. I'm still in this whatever area for Queen, but eventually we'll get to the good ones.
That's fair enough. We're still in the median areas. All right. Top 10. Here we go. Number 10, Jazz. All right. So I know you might not agree with me on this one because you like Bicycle Race. You told me that yesterday.
You love Bicycle Race.
So I really enjoy Bicycle Race myself, but I think you enjoy it more than I do. But I do enjoy Bicycle Race. You have Don't Stop Me Now on here. Like, are you kidding me? That's a top 10 Queen song out of all their discography right there. Like, Don't Stop Me Now, that's a feel-good song to get you up and dancing and just happy if you don't want to dance. It makes you happy. It's wonderful. I love that. And Dreamer's Ball is kind of nice because I could see, like, it being played at a ball, a very extravagant ball, and it's like nice and kind of sway a little bit. And I mean, Jealousy is another one of those really emotional Mercury songs that is just, you can feel the emotion in the song. You can feel it. Like the first time I ever heard this album, like that was the standout song to me, was that one. I absolutely loved it. And I know that you did not really enjoy Mustafa. but I can get down with that song. I can get down with that song. I think that one is very cool. And that's my take on Jazz and all that jazz.
You like jazz? Not really, apparently.
It's top 10, so it's not bad. It's not good either.
Now, for this one, you know, like, obviously, I want it all bang so hard. Even if this album version, because I only really knew the Greatest Hits version, which has, like, the chanting intro. So even this longer version that I don't prefer still is really good. It's really good. The Invisible Man bass line goes so hard. Shout out to Big D.
We love Big D over here.
My Baby Does Me was kind of smooth. And yeah, I think this is where we start to bump up a little bit.
Next level.
Over the last few, so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Miracle starts to get good.
It's a miracle.
It's a miracle. We're on the good records.
Ah, yes. My ninth favorite Queen album is one that you've already talked about, Made in Heaven. Now, this album is just something that's, whenever I listen to it, I can feel it. And obviously, like, I'm saying this for a lot of those Mercury songs, but because of at the stage he was at in his life and the way that he was singing, especially on Mother Love, don't even get me started, I'm gonna cry. But, like, Brian May sings that last line of Mother Love because Freddie couldn't do it. And that, like, it hurts when I hear that song, but just, like, all the powerfulness that you hear when he is singing is just like, oh my gosh. Like, he literally did this till the day he died, and he still sounded top-notch, amazing, hands down, the best frontman of any band, singer ever. Yes, Freddie. Like, that is it. And, I mean, you also have I Was Born to Love You. Wow. That one is just like, oh, like, I Was Born to Love You. Like, every single being of my heart. Are you kidding me? Like, that just, that kind of gets me in my feels a little bit. Like, that's so sweet that somebody would write that. That somebody loves somebody that much. It's, what lyrics can do is amazing, and paired with the perfect voice, I swear. And then you kind of get on to, like, You Don't Fool Me, which is kind of opposite of that. And it's like, no, like, you've fooled me in the past, but, like, you're not going to do this to me anymore. Like, I got to leave. So it's like, it's opposite of that. And so this album is like an emotional roller coaster, but in a really good way, and also in a not so good way, in the real sense of, like, what I was saying about Freddie's situation and just recording until the end of his life. It's a bittersweet album, but, like, this is the album where I can definitely say, yes, this is where we're really starting to get good here.
As you can see here in not only the title card and here, but also back there. Ooh. Next up, we have News of the World. Yes, the very frightening image of Frank.
Frank.
Yeah, man. I was surprised to see that We Will Rock You opens this thing. I thought those two would have been like at the end. But yeah, really good way to kick off the album. We Are the Champions. I mean, it's kind of like dopey rock. But it's really good dopey rock, and always one of my favorite songs by them.
Oh, that reminds me of you.
Oh, dude. But unfortunately, those two are really the only songs that make this placement make it be up here, because everything else is just kind of okay. Like, oof, well, I just think they, in the sense of misfire, they kind of blew their loads with the first couple of tracks.
I don't know him.
But then there's the part, there's like a faster part in It's Late that's pretty good. I really like that, but there's only like one section of that song that really did that. And yeah, really only because of those two songs. I just really like them. That's all I have to say about Frank.
At number 8, we've got It's a Kind of Magic. It's a Kind of Magic. It's a Kind of Magic that we made it to number 8, and you're gonna laugh at me because you know I kind of got just a little bit of beef with the title track, It's a Kind of Magic, because every single time I hook my phone up in my car, that is always the first song that plays. So I hear the beginning of it every single day. And so it's kind of like if you set a song as an alarm that wakes you up, and then every time you hear that song, you're like, oh my gosh, I gotta get up. And you have that feeling, and it's not like the greatest feeling in the world. I'm kind of starting to get that with It's a Kind of Magic. But it's a really good song, and I love the music video because I read somewhere that all of the animations, like those cartoon guys that you were talking about on the stage, those were actually animated by Disney's animators. Wow. So it was a very cool music video where they were all kind of like hobos in like an abandoned mansion. That's like the best way I can describe it. And it's just a really cool, funny music video. Then, I mean, you got One Vision opens this album up. And Queen and Adam Lambert used to open up their concerts with One Vision. And so I thought that that was really fitting when they would do that. And that's a really good song to open up an album with. Love One Vision. And 1 Year of Love is beautiful.
It's, just one.
Yeah, just one. No more, no less. Just 1 year. And like you were saying, Who Wants to Live Forever is on here. Every time I hear that song now, I just think of the scene in Bohemian Rhapsody where Freddie learns that he has AIDS and he's like laying in his bed and he like passes the TV where he's like the AIDS epidemic and the clips that are on there. It's just like, I think about that and I just, it hurts my heart so much. But it's such a good song though, especially when it, like right at the end there, when it goes into this big chorus and like the big strings and orchestrations and everything. It just like, it makes the song. It makes it. It's beautiful. And Friends Will Be Friends right till the end. I seriously, like, look, I don't exactly know what that song is about, but I hope it's about all four of them because that would just make my heart so happy. I would love that. And I feel like one song that people don't really talk about too much is Princes of the Universe, and I think that song's really underrated. I really thoroughly enjoy that song. It's like, it's so much pride in that song. Like, I feel like when I listen to it, I just like sit up just a little bit taller. Like, it's, I love it. It's powerful. It's great. And just, it, the whole album just really comes together.
All right. And somewhere where this album actually kind of belongs, we have Queen number 2. And this is still in their little, the first two are kind of more in that proggy side. So that's why I really like these first two. But first up, we have the second one. And yeah, Father to Son is pretty solid. It gets pretty decently heavy for Queen, like in the middle of the song. Like you mentioned, we got White Queen, very similar. Like, I think this album is very similar to the first one that basically flows the same. You know, we start with a super, like, jammy song, and then we get a few long proggy songs, and then the Roger song, which I kind of really like on this song, or this album. It's very similar to the first one for me, but I just kind of like the first album song just a little bit more than two. But both very good.
All right. I'm ready for number 7.
Are you ready for... Are you ready for number 7?
Yes, I'm ready for a sheer heart attack at number 7. And we open up this album with Brighton Rock. And it's kind of like... I always kind of looked past this song when I was younger. But when we listen to these albums again, I always thought it was a little weird a little bit. But I think it's kind of cool that we open up with this carnival-esque type of, like, opening. Like, the music you'd hear on a carousel. And then it just, like, kind of gets into this, like, back and forth between these two people. I think this song is unique. I think it's fun. And it's a pretty decent way to open an album. But, I mean, after that, you've got Killer Queen. Ooh, Killer Queen, just the... You just hear those snaps and you know you're in for a good song. You absolutely know. It's, that song is so Freddy. It's the Moet and Chandon, like, ah, yes, it's Freddy. I love it. I can just feel the vibe. It's wonderful. And flick of the wrist. I love just the emotions of flick of the wrist. I love the emotions in that song so much. It's like, I don't even know how to describe it. It's kind of like evil a little bit, like bad and evil, but like in kind of a good way. It's weird, but I love it. And Lily of the Valley is another one of those pretty short little songs. Love it. Kind of has that fairy tale-esque kind of feel to it. Definitely love that one. And we have Roger's wonderful falsetto scream in the Lap of the Gods there. So that one, seriously, even when I know the song is coming, it scares me every single time. Every single time. That's something that I will never, ever in my life has an alarm, because every morning when I wake up, I will have a sheer heart attack. And I mean, and Brian's song, She Makes Me, is, even him, you can hear the emotion in his voice and, like, saying, like, what his love makes him feel and, like, how she kind of, like, shapes his life is just wonderful. And also, like, at the end where you kind of hear the sirens, it's just like, oh, maybe it's not such a good thing. So maybe it's kind of like a little twist at the end there. But this album with the emotions again, this, oh, yes, yes. Highly recommend this one.
Like I said, 2 and 1 are pretty damn close, and yeah, just only one away from each other. Yeah, Keep Yourself Alive, introduction to the entire band. Good way to start. My Fairy King was definitely interesting. Not the kind of stuff I would expect from Queen, but then again, this was their first album, so I mean, anything kind of goes.
Experimental.
Liar is some straight up prog stuff. A lot of different parts with all these things going on. And then, yeah, Seven Seas Arise, I'm also not crazy about. Although I think that's on the second album.
If you turn that up, though.
Yeah, I mean, Baby's first hit, you know, it's like, it's all right, but they definitely just got better as they went on. But yeah, good album with a lot of pretty decent tracks.
We're going to continue with number 6, which is The Works. Okay, so The Works opens up with Radio Gaga, which I told you the story of this one. This was when Roger's kid Rufus was drawing or doing something. He was listening to the radio, and his mom is French, and so he spoke some French, and he didn't like what was being played on the radio, so he's like, Radio Kaka. So I think that's really funny. And now we've got Radio Gaga, which was made into like a completely different thing. This is like a pro radio song, and you know, working with radio and stuff, you know, I'm a very big fan of that song. And because Roger wrote it, so you know, I'm not biased.
Daddy Roger.
I'm not biased or anything, I swear. No. Yes, I Want to Break Free. Best Queen music video, hands down. I loved it in high school when I dressed up. I think it was my freshman year of high school that I dressed up as Roger in drag. Rogerina. And everybody thought I was Britney Spears. And I'm like, no. No.
How dare you not get this very specific reference?
I mean, I knew that people wouldn't understand it, but I, you know what? It was just me having fun. My neighbors got it. My friends understood it. And that's all that mattered. I thought it was hilarious. And the song itself is really cool, too. Is This the World We Created? Is just like, I feel like this can really relate to any time in history. This is a song that is still very much relevant. And this is a song that we heard at the Queen concert last night when we saw them too. They sang this. Like, this is a realistic song. And this is a realistic song that sticks with me. You know, like, this is a topic that I think should be talked about even more. You know, it's like, look at all these hungry children we have to feed and, you know, all of these different problems that can definitely be solved. But it's a good reminder. I think it's a really good reminder that we gotta get our priorities straight. And a song that really surprised me, because I wasn't super familiar with the works until I listened to it this time around, Keep Passing the Open Windows. That was such a great song. This was I love it. I love the feeling that I get from hearing it. It's nice. It's wonderful. And this was like a little piece of like extra like bonus for me that I didn't really know about or wasn't super familiar with. So kudos to them for making a really awesome like song, even though that one is also very underrated.
Right back to Sheer Heart Attack. Yo, Stone Cold Crazy.
You know?
The most underrated Queen song, most certainly. The one of the quintessential seeds that planted, oof, that became thrash metal. But yeah, like you mentioned, another really solid opener with Brighton Rock. I just think the first few albums all had really, really good first tracks. And then, yeah, I'm sorry, Killer Queen is not my super favorite song.
Oh.
But I could still get down with it, I suppose. But then this album, it does get a little silly with Misfire and Leroy Brown. But, and then, did you mention She Makes Me?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought it was boring. I thought that was a boring song. Lap of Gods, really good outro too.
Yes.
But yeah, I think I already started the good Queen albums. I think two, I think, starts it. Yeah, these first three, they're really good.
Yeah.
I mean, the first, a lot, are very good. But yeah, it just gets better.
I think it's pretty cool that this album opens up with two songs that kind of flow into each other. We start off with Party and then go on to Khashoggi's Ship. Party's just like, cool. Like, hey, like, this is the start of the album. We're going to, like, start having a party here. Like, you're invited. Let's go. That's really cool. Like you were saying, I Want It All. Awesome, awesome tune. I love that one. That's awesome. Breakthrough. Love that one, actually. And the music video for that is actually very cool as well, with the train and all of them in there. Like, I love that one. Scandal. Ooh, like, I can just imagine the story in my head. Just the song Scandal. I can imagine it. And I love when songs make me imagine things. I think that's great. Scandal. Love that. And, like, was it all worth it? I feel like that's maybe not just Freddie, but I feel like maybe, like, the whole band's kind of like, was everything worth it to get to this point that we're at now? And then at the end of the song, they're just like, yeah. Yeah, it was definitely worth it. And this album gets extra credit for one of the bonus songs. One of the bonus songs that, like, when I was, like, super in love with Queen when I was, like, 13 and 14 years old.
When it was all Daddy Roger. You can say it.
I'm not going to say that. But Hijack My Heart is amazing, and I play that one over and over again. And I'm not going to lie, when I was younger, I wrote Queen fan fiction, and that's what I named the first ever fan fiction that I wrote, was Hijack My Heart. And it was a picture of me and Roger standing next to a car with a cat in it.
Oh my God.
So that's a bonus. That's an extra credit song. I highly recommend that one.
We're here at the pinnacle of the top. The pinnacle of the top, all right? So, up next, we have A Day at the Races.
Oh!
Where it actually belongs, right? At number 5. Hell yeah, man. I really like the piano in Take My Breath Away.
Yes.
I think it sounds, yes, really good in there. And then, yeah, parts of, like, Millionaire Waltz, like you said, was really neat. And then you got You and I, which is also, mm-hmm, pretty solid. A lot more mid-tempo, like, crowd vocal stuff.
I had no idea that the robot had a name until Brian May said something, like, a few years back, and he's just like, yeah, his name's Frank. I'm like, really? What, like, you'd think for a robot it'd be, like, something, like, futuristic or something, like, Zyborg or something. I don't know. But Frank! Hey, if Queen says Frank, I like Frank, you know? Anywho, besides being a massive Frank fan, like you said, like, I thought it was a little odd that this opened up with We Will Rock You, We're the Champions, but I'm not complaining. I think this is actually fantastic because, I mean, it's promising. They're promising that we will be rocked. This whole album will rock us. And it does. I mean, it's number 4. So, yeah, it does. Thank you very much. Which, you know, a bunch of that stuff was, like, shot in Roger's backyard. So, and they were kind of out of it a little bit. But it was still fun. It was still fun. We have my all-time favorite Queen song on here. My numero uno Queen song, Spread Your Wings. Love that song. It's, like... like, so, what do you want to call it? Motivational. It's so motivational. It's, like, this dude who just, like, starts in, like, a little bar or whatever, and then he just, like, wants to make his, like, he wants to make his mark on the world, and it's amazing. I love motivational songs, especially when they are sung by one of my heroes, and Freddie is one of my personal heroes, so just hearing him sing this stuff is just, like, it makes me want to, like, accomplish more in my life. So are we going to talk about this Roger song called Fight From the Inside?
I'm not. I don't remember that one.
I do. And very, very powerful. Very powerful, strong. I can feel it. I can feel the vocals. And I love that. And it ends off with my melancholy blues. And I always loved singing this one. And that's why it's like one of my favorites on this album, just because it's kind of jazzy a little bit. And I love Freddie's voice, how it just kind of like gets high and it gets like super low. And it just encompasses all the emotion that he's supposed to be feeling throughout this song. Ugh, love it. Beautiful album.
All right, well, you know it wouldn't be a DK video without a few hot takes here and there, right? So here's my next one. The so-called best Queen album, A Night at the Opera. Almost. It's number 4. Close, but not quite. All right, so we have 39. 39 is a nice song. I really like the vocal melody in there. The Prophet song is all right, but there's like the, I don't know, it's like 2 minutes or so, like in the middle, where it's just, the whole thing is just, Now I Know, over and over again. And they might know, but I don't think I know about that. All right. I don't think so. And then we have Good Company, which was just kind of a weird song. But then, of course, you have the... I posed this question yesterday, but does anyone know if Roger still has the car that he wrote about in this album? Because he sure really loved that car. Let me tell you what. And then, of course, we have... Love of My Life is... It's a nice song. I'm not going to listen to it ever. Unless I listen to this whole thing. But it's a nice song. But then you have... Let's be real, the GOAT. The actual GOAT. Arguably, like, top 3 greatest songs ever written with Bohemian Rhapsody. Like, I mean, how could you, like, not agree, right? You all get it. How could you not agree? If you don't, what's wrong with you, honestly? But yeah, Night at the Opera, full of great stuff, but I'm sorry, but there's just other albums full of even greater stuff.
A Night at the Opera is my number 3.
Yeah, how about that? close to a double whammy, but not quite.
Close. I mean, okay, so we're going to start off here with Death on Two Legs. I mean, if I remember correctly, this was written about, like, the record company or just people stealing money from them with the records and everything.
Oh, no, I read about that. Dedicated to. It was the...
Yeah.
I don't remember the exact guy, but, like, their old manager or something. Yeah. And he got really pissy and tried to sue them for defamation, even though they never said his name.
Yeah.
So, what an asshole.
It's oh, like, they just have some, like, not necessarily, like, super crude things to say about him, but, like, kind of. But, like, it's, like, yes, like, stick it to the man. Yes.
Suck my blood like a leech.
Yeah,
you
I break
know. The law and then you breach. Screw my brain till it hurts. You've taken all my money, but and now you want more.
Yeah, see? It's wonderful. I'm not going to talk about every song on here, but Lazing on a Sunday Afternoon is just a cute little bouncy little number, and I love it, and it's cute. And then we've got I'm in Love with My Car. I think this is pretty obvious that that used to be my username on Instagram way back when used to be Roger Taylor's car. So.
Oh, my God. Unbelievable.
It is not that anymore, but, you know, it is what it is. Great song, by the way. You're My Best Friend. Oh, that's another one of my...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I totally forgot to write the hits because I wanted to shout out, you know, other songs more. But, yeah, it's a great song, too.
Yeah, that's another one of, like, my all-time favorite Queen songs. Like, John Deacon wrote that about his wife.
I don't even know the song.
John Deacon wrote that about his wife? Are you kidding me? Like, that's so sweet. I love that. And a lot of people I know have different, like, meanings of it. Like, some people depict it of, like, man's best friend, like a man and his dog, or just a group of friends.
The
or something.
Bros, man, the bros.
Like, it doesn't matter because people feel different things, but I just think it's really cute that John Deacon wrote it for his wife. I love that. Like, that's his best friend. Are you kidding me? I love that. It's so sweet. And then, I mean, you've got, okay, you say that you love Love of My Life, and you won't listen to it unless you hear the whole album. This is another one of my top favorite Queen songs of all time. I melt with this song. It is the beautiful harp in there. Freddie is the voice. Everything about that song is absolutely perfect. It's just perfect. There's no better word to describe it than perfect. I love that song. And, of course, I mean, like, you were talking about Bohemian Rhapsody. I mean, look, if you don't sing every single part to Bohemian Rhapsody, even if you can't hit the notes...
Even the harmonies. You gotta hit all the harmonies.
You're doing it wrong.
Galileo, 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 Galileo. Yeah, you gotta do all the parts.
Yeah, even if you look like a lunatic, I don't care. Nobody cares. If they know that you're singing Bohemian Rhapsody, they'll be like, yes, that's how you do it. You yeah, gotta do all the parts.
Wayne's World really hit the mark with that one.
Yeah, yeah. That was a cool scene. And I'm gonna come back here. Good Company's gonna make a comeback. I think that's a really cute song. Thank you, Brian May. I think it's a cute little bouncy little tune.
Sir Brian May.
Sir Brian May. That's to everybody, but you know. Sir Brian May. And he's knocking it out of the park with that and 39. Like, good job, Sir Brian May. That is amazing. And you deserve a lot of credit for both of those. Those are fantastic songs. So, fantastic. Wonderful album. Yay.
We're in top three, top two territory, and there's still two albums neither of us have talked about. So, obviously, we're on similar wavelengths with those two. Honestly, I think Mustafa is genuinely the worst Queen song. Like, the worst one. And I think it's just kind of a disaster. But other than that, man, pretty much everything else on this album. Like, in Jealousy, there's some piano licks that I like. Entertain You and Dead on Time are just rocking as hell. You know, you just got, like, the first half of the record that's just constantly, like, banger after banger after banger. But then, like, it slows down drastically with, like, 7 days. For last couple tracks, I'm not crazy about, but, like, Bicycle Race and Don't Stop Me Now. Like, two massive bangers in here that just shot this album up, like, 5 points.
Wholeheartedly agree.
5 ranking placements. Damn good songs. But, yeah, now we're in the top two, and let's see if we can double whammy on both of them because we both have the same top two, but
okay.
In what order?
Okay.
What's up first?
Could I have a drum roll for this one? Because this is innuendo.
Damn it.
No.
Damn it. Could have been cool. Could have been cool, man.
Sorry, master.
Whatever. Whatever.
Anyway, at number two, we have innuendo. And,
You chose wrong. You thought wrong, dude.
I don't think so. I don't think so. We've got Sneaky Steve Howe on innuendo. Steve Howe's on this one. He was playing the flamenco guitar. And I had no idea until like a couple years ago when I was preparing for a completely different project. And I'm like, oh, Steve Howe played on innuendo and I had no idea like my whole life. Are you kidding me? That is super cool. And made that song just itself just kind of jump up a little bit. Just with that little fact right there. And I'm going slightly mad. I feel like that's like a daily theme song for me. Honestly. I mean, with the dogs and sometimes the commute to work and a bunch of other stuff. I feel like sometimes I am going slightly mad. And the wonderful, when I was younger, I took a picture of myself with the bananas on my head, like Freddie had in the music video. So I felt like I was a banana tree, apparently. I mean, then you have Don't Try So Hard, which resonates with me so much. Oh my gosh, I can totally relate to that song. And if I can relate to a song and it sounds emotional and everything about it is perfect, it's just a home run for me. It has everything that I need in there. These Are the Days of Our Lives. Don't even get me started with that music video. And at the end where Freddie says, I still love you. And that phrase is meant for all of his fans. Like, it's like, are you kidding me? It's like every single time I hear that song, it literally is like Freddie is speaking to me. Because he's speaking to all of us. He still loves us. Even though he's not here. And it's nice.
Yeah, speaking of Bowie, it kind of like, it's thematically, nice. It's similar to Black Star, right?
Oh, don't even say that. The reason I don't listen...
They just kind of knew and they wanted to say goodbye.
No, the reason I don't listen to Black Star is because I know it's about Bowie's death. I can't listen to it without crying. Great. Thank you for that. That was my number two album. Wonderful. Anywho... Can we just talk about Delilah for a sec? Like, he wrote that about one of his cats. I love when musicians write songs about their pets. It shows so much compassion. It's like he loves her even when she pees all over his Chippendale suite. Like, that's love right there. Like, come on. Between a person and their pet is I know how much he loved his cats, so that song is just another one that makes my heart so happy. And we're gonna end this one off with The Show Must Go On. Like, I feel like this is sort of like appropriate, at least the ending to the song is kind of appropriate. It's weird because like at the end where it repeats, go on, go on, go on. It's like a record skipping. I don't know if I want to put it like this, but I guess in a sense, that's what they do now. Because when you see them in concert, they pretty much play the same songs all the time. It's almost like a broken record. But however, this is a good thing because these are all the songs that people really enjoy. So I kind of understand that ending a little bit. Other people might take it differently, and that's totally fine because this is just an opinion, but it's like, but not only that, but Queen will go on, go on, go on. Like their music will literally go on. They're just one of those timeless bands like the Beatles where they'll just pass through generations of music and like people will know them for hundreds of years. Like they just will. So thematically ending it's an appropriate ending. So that's all I gotta say about that. But that's just a really, really good album.
If we were ranking artworks, this would be dead last. I mean, are you shitting me?
They look
cool. It is such a lazy image.
They look cool.
It actually kind of angers me. This just looks like those generic, the essential band tracks. You guys, you all know what I'm talking about. The the gray borders and just like the photo of them. It is so lazy. It's called The Game. They could have just been playing Monopoly. That could have been the artwork and it would have been funny. It would have been awesome. But no, whatever. We're not talking about artworks. We're talking about the songs. And with the title track, I swear, the first 20 seconds or whatever is like The Exorcist. And then the rest of the song is Cinderella. Where they do not mix. Yeah, it's like the creepiest intro ever. And then it's manu, manu, just the piano. It's like, all right, man, well, whatever. But yeah, the rest of the song is pretty solid too. Dragon Attack. That is funk right there. Yes. Straight funk. Shout out to Big D. Don't Try Suicide is the goofiest PSA I've ever heard in my life because it kind of makes you want to try it because it sounds fun. Don't try suicide. You know? It's like if the Wiggles made the suicide prevention song. And then, of course, we have, you know, Save Me. I always really like to. Save Me is a great finale. Another one, Bites the Dust, obviously. Crazy Little Thing Called Love, Walgreens Core, but still completely valid. Damn close. These top two are damn close. But one thing pushes the other one over this one. And now it's your turn to talk about this album because this is your number one.
Yeah, this is my number one. And can I just give y'all a little tidbit on this artwork here, please? This is from the music video Crazy Little Thing Called Love. That's where that shot was taken from. So this shot actually goes with this album, and they were not being lazy. They put a whole production. They dressed like this for the production.
For the video?
Yeah.
And then they just took a screenshot of the video and slapped it on the artwork?
Well, no, they didn't have... I don't think they had screenshots back then. I think that they just did, like, promo, like a promo shoot, you know? Oh. Play the game. I actually wrote a poem when I was in college using lyrics from Play the Game. So I think that that song is very cool. Open up your mind and let me step inside. I just, ooh, I love, just that one line is, I love it. Yes, let's keep going. And you brought up Dragon Attack. Like, that's a song that you just, you turn up and just get down. And he says get down in the song. So you get down to it.
Out of all the songs that I've heard that I never heard before, that's definitely up there.
Yeah.
Very good song.
That, I always like that one. Another one, Bites the Dust. I mean, you know, wonderful bass line by John Deacon. And they went out for pizza and they forgot it. And then somebody in the band was just like, oh yeah, this is how it went. And that was, I think that's a really funny story. You didn't even talk about Rocket Prime Jive. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? That's
I talked
wonderful.
About it,
that's a wonderful song. Like, it starts off like kind of slow and it's a little deceptive because then it just picks up and it's like, yes, it's a rockin' song, and I just want to get up and dance to that one. It's just amazing. Yes, probably one of the best songs, if not the best song on this album, is Rocket Prime Jive. Let's go. You're right, dude. Get out of here. And then we've got the beautiful Sail Away, Sweet Sister with Brian on the vocals again. This is another one that he just, like, really just vocally, emotionally got into, and I just feel it, and it is... just, yes, yes, please, I love it. And then let's, you know, with ending with Save Me is just, Save Me, I can't face this life alone. I'm naked and I'm far from home. It's just like somebody feel like they're going through their life alone and they just need somebody. Like, they just need someone, just one person. And just the emotion, and it's sad, and it's, but it's like beautiful in that way. And This album, it has everything. There's not a single song on this album that I would skip. It makes me laugh. It makes me cry. It makes me happy. It makes me want to dance. It has everything. The Game is amazing.
But not quite as amazing as... Actually, I gotta be honest. When I finished listening to these albums, like when I was about putting my list together, it took me like 15 minutes to decide which album I liked more. Okay. I'll be totally honest. And realistically, I almost did what you did, like by using math, because there's 5 I like on the game and 4 I really like on Innuendo.
Okay.
And those 4 are the first 3 tracks. First 3, right?
Your math.
Title track, Sneaky Steve Howe.
Yes, Sneaky Steve.
I didn't know that for the longest time, but that definitely makes it cooler. Always loved how it starts, you know, with the snares and the triplets and like the strings. And then, yeah, the whole Spanish guitar interlude. So damn cool. I'm Going Slightly Mad. Super jammy song. Makes me just want to like bob my head to it. Also, love the way he sings it. Like, he's actually going mad. It finally happened, my dear, whatever. I'm going insane, because who doesn't feel like they're going slightly mad? And then Headlong. Headlong was always one of my favorite songs, just like how fast-paced it is, and it's super catchy. And then we have other songs that are pretty solid, too, like Don't Try So Hard and Ride the Wild Wind. Mm-hmm. The Hitman are solid. And then the 4th track that is the main highlight, which, of course, is The Show Must Go On, which is my favorite Queen song, right?
That's a fantastic Queen song.
So we have 5 over here and 4 over here, but one of those 4 is my favorite song, so that counts as 2. So there's 5 and 5. And ultimately, I was just like, I guess I'll take the one with my favorite song. I mean, and the better artwork. That helps, too. But... yeah, man, Show Must Go On. Ever since I heard it as a wee child, 7 years old or whatever I was, the string, like the bop, the fucking, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
This thing, and then those 4 toms in the beginning, and just the way he sings it, and especially when you know the fact that he was already, you know. It was kind of out of luck for him.
Do you know the fact about that song? That it was recorded in one take? That, you know, like, Queen was recording that day, and then, I guess, you know, Freddie was getting a little tired, and one of the guys, I believe it was Brian, was just like, all right, you know, let's just take a break, maybe that's it for the day, and, you know, Freddie just slams a bottle on the desk, and he's like, I'm gonna effing do it, darling, and then he just does the song in one take? Like, are you kidding me? He was so sick, and he was dying, and he did it in one take, and it sounds like that, and it's perfect?
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
I believe it.
Yes.
Yeah, and the lyrics, especially. The idea of the show must go on, like, feels like he was giving them the blessing to continue. Like, guys, you all keep this going. All 3 of you can do this, even though one of you is about to not never do this again. But you guys keep doing it, and yeah, just lyrically, soul painted like wings of a butterfly, I'll never give in, I'll fight it to the end, all that. It's just how you were talking about motivational with Spread Your Wings. I feel like that with Show Must Go On.
I agree with that. I was
just like, never stop.
Yeah, and I mean, he did ultimately give them their blessing. He was like, yeah, as long as you don't make me boring, then go ahead.
Yeah, man. So, yeah, because it has my favorite song on there, pushes over top over the game, and that's why it's my favorite Queen album. Ooh. Well, there you have it. 15 albums, twice over, so realistically it was like 30. Over an hour. Hope you all enjoyed. We're going to go back to Hyrule. And save the kingdom.
Yeah, you gotta save me too, obviously, or else there wouldn't be a game.
God, I'm so glad that I finally was able to hear all these albums after listening to this band for 20 years.
Yeah.
Took me a little long, but I finally did it.
Yeah.
And, well, as for what's next, I guess it's... Speaking of 20 years, yo, we got this guy who's about to drop an album after... not dropping one for like 20 years. I don't know if it's actually 20 years, but it's been a long time. So, that dude's next. So, stick around.